Jan Bhatia, the military operations along the line of control has become so common these days, and it becomes, and the relations between India and Pakistan have, I think, at the lowest ebb today, and the peace of both the nations has been disturbed to a great extent. You've been a former DGMO, and you have been interacting with the hierarchy of Pakistan army and civil authorities. What in your opinion should be the strategy to even out this particular differences and bring some sort of peace in the region?
Sir, you're right. The immediate concern, the present danger comes from the line of control, comes from terrorism which is exported from Pakistan. But in the end, we have to live with our neighbors. We have to live in a peaceful neighbor. And as the nation aims to transform into a modern, prosperous, secure nation, we have to understand that security is an imperative for economic development, for growth, long-term peace, stability. The line of control is, the ceasefire was there from 25th November 2003. It is not a ceasefire agreement. It is an agreed upon ceasefire. As of 25th November, the DGMO of Pakistan spoke to the DGMO of India, and they agreed to have a ceasefire. And the ceasefire has been under stress, especially in 2019. There have been 3,200 ceasefire violations. But you look at the ceasefire violations, it is mainly because of two factors. And one of the major factors is infiltration from across the line of control by the Pakistan terrorist groups, fully supported by Pakistan army. So Pakistan has to understand that it cannot keep exporting terrorism to India, and India will suffer in perpetuity. India will suffer with impunity. It's not going to happen. Our counter-terrorism strategy has undergone a change. Punitive and preemptive operations are part of the counter-terrorism strategy. And to put pressure on Pakistan, whenever there is firing from the Pakistani side, that is mainly for the purpose of infiltration. That is why, if you see, there has been no ceasefire violations east of Zozila. We have about 200 kilometers of land of control east of Zozila and Siachen Glacier. Why are there no ceasefire violations out there? There are no ceasefire violations out there because infiltration from there is not really feasible. It can happen. I'm not saying it can't happen, but it is not cost effective. It is not feasible. It takes a long, long time for them to come. There are many other dangers. Weather is one of them. Terrain is the second one. So the ceasefire violations are now restricted to areas of high infiltration, which is possible. So Pakistan has to understand that India has to keep retaliating because it has to be two ways. And I think the CBMs, which is the confidence building measures in place, have been totally shattered. They need to grow again. The DGMO hotline is an excellent one. And I must say, 2013 December, the Pakistan DGM invited me. I'd gone across, and for 6 months there was a single ceasefire violation. So it is not it can't be done. It can be done. We have to ensure decent sanctity along the line of control. If that happens, now the strategy, if you ask me, I don't think Kashmir, Pakistan considered, Pakistan always says Kashmir is the problem. I don't think Kashmir is the problem. Kashmir is a manifestation. It is not a problem. And Pakistan has used the Kashmiri people for the agenda. So Kashmir has to understand that things are changing. We had the most peaceful 2019 in Kashmir since many, many years. It is down to less than 300 violence levels, fatalities, which is one of the lowest in many, many years. So what we are seeing is a change in Kashmir, and Pakistan has actually has got certain options, but it has lost the steam. And if we can maintain peace in Kashmir, we can maintain some sort of a semblance of line of control, raise the cost of Pakistan, I think finally Pakistan will come down and ask for ceasefire, as it had done in 2003 also. 2003 was a unilateral ceasefire. So we have to understand that Pakistan does understand the language which it speaks, and we have to put pressure on Pakistan, not only militarily but economically. We have to put pressure on Pakistan diplomatically. And another thing which we need to do is, in the end, what do we want Pakistan to do? We want Pakistan to change its behavior towards India. That's what we want. And if we can start reviewing the IWT, the Indus Border Treaty, I think that put a lot of pressure on Pakistan. So it has to be a synergetic effort at the diplomatic front, in the information domain, in the military domain, and the economic domain. It still carries the most favored nation, I don't know why.
I agree with you, sir. I think the 370 and 35 abrogations has definitely made a change in Kashmir. And you rightly said that things are changing. And we are very confident, at least in aviation defense universe and the people we meet with, they are very confident that things will be brighter to do tomorrow for Kashmir and for the relations between J&K and India. I will not say J&K in India, J&K in the rest of the country. Sir, the another problem is the cyber crimes, which are external threat, and especially for the defense services data. Now, how do we combat that?
Sir, the Aviation Defense Universe were doing a lot of work on this field, among others. I think the future challenges are going to be in the cyber domain. And these will be, one will be direct cyber threats, and settled through the cyber media, which talk of perception management, the information war. As far as the Indian military is concerned, we have the Defense Cyber Agency, which has been raised in 2019. Though it should have been a command, but well, it's not a command, it's an agency. So they have to put into place the cyber policy, the cyber strategy. The National Cyber Security Strategy is 31st is our last day for giving it inputs. So that has already been done, actually. So cyber strategy we should be seeing in the next 5 to 6 months. And based on that, we need to institute a very robust defensive measures, actually, which also include educating, awareness. Then we have infection through the various parts which you get, most of them are made in China.
Yes.
So the supply chain infection has to be able to see that. So things are moving, but yes, sir, you are right, absolutely. Cyber will remain a very major threat, and cyber direct warfare, and also the information war, which is through cyber means. Today, why do nations go to war? Nations go to war because they want to impose their will on the adversary. But today they don't have to go to war to do that. Today we're looking at virtual societal warfare. I'm changing the behavior pattern through a societal warfare, through the media, through the IW. So that is what is going to be very important. So we've got to be geared up for that, and we need to structure for that at the national level. We've got to structure at the military also.
Very well said, sir. I think we have taken great cognizance of this particular aspect of the new dimension of warfare. Coming to Make in India. Make in India, is it a mantra for Indianization and inventory control management? Or do you think is a stumbling block in this process?
Sir, and let me be candid about it. Make in India can do much, much better. We have to do. You see, the government has changed the policies, but the processes and the procedures still remain lethargic and slow and lengthy. So the process and the procedures need to be now. 2016, the DPP was there, it was reviewed in 2020. But review of the DPP, the Defence Procurement Procedures, has to also make sure that the procedures and the processes which lead to the procurements also has to be reviewed. Make in India has to be more industry friendly. India in the long run, if you want to be a global leader, which we have to be self-reliant in defense manufacturing. We are the largest importers of arms. 63% of military hardware is exports. We cannot continue that. Make in India an excellent initiative, but it is not translated in the way it was expected to translate on the ground. The strategic partnership model is just about starting. I hope in 2020 it will take off. The foreign direct investment, the FDI, is also weak. So we have to make sure the process and the procedure friendly, and the army, the military, that is, the industry, the scientific community, the DRDO, R&D, they have to sit together and they have to come on the same platform. There is convergence of ideas, but we have to sit together with the government and make sure that the procedure processes are friendly to them, and the army and the military especially has to do some hand holding. So that is important, and we should look at the next 5 to 10 years where we reduce our imports by about another 50% and then another 25%, and other than cutting edge technologies, we should be self-reliant. And for that, R&D is a must. The DRDO, the Defence Factory Board, which are the major contributors, over 55,000 crores spent in the Defence Factory, they have to contribute to the military.
So my last question. You have such vast experience, not on the national scene, but even international scene. Maldives, you were greatly involved in the operation of Maldives when they came to India for support, when they had some problem. with this vast experience in the defense forces, and now with St. Joe's, what message would you like to give to the young children, or what strategy you would propose for them to join the defense forces, which is still very deficient of army officers?
Now, that's a key issue. Our deficiency in the leadership, actually, in the junior leadership. Having said that, means our junior leaders are the best. I would not have even imagined to do what they can do today. Whether intellectually or even mental strength wise or professionally, they are much, much better than what sir, you and me ever were. Sorry, but that's the
fact. I agree with you, 100%.
But there is deficiency in the officers. The reason is that it is not because of people, our countrymen are not opting for it. For the National Defence Academy, we have about 3 lakh optees, we have set about 350 odd. It is the quality we are talking about.
Yes.
The quality intake is not there. And
among
the men, there is no problem at all. It's just the officers' bit. And that is a growing concern, because today so much avenues are open to the young people. And somehow the armed forces also need a higher status in the civil hierarchy. Today, unfortunately, that is not so. People think that in the armed forces they cannot rise to a certain level. It is dangerous. It is very risky out there, and they are not being fully compensated for that. So we have to have a look at what are the aspirations of the young people. We have to address the aspiration, and we have to see the organization needs also. And we have to have congruence between the aspirations of our young people and organization needs. It is not that tomorrow if we say something, we will start coming in. We are reaching out to the young people, but then the young, they have their own avenues, they have their own priorities. The world is a changed world. When sir, you joined, you didn't have, I suppose the best option was the army. When I joined, the best option was the army. But today it is not the best option, it is not the preferred option. And simply because even parents don't want their children to join the army, for the rest. That's a fact. If you look at the market value of matrimony, people don't want their daughters to marry army officers because the risk is involved. So we'll have to, the strategy has to be very clear. It requires national effort, it cannot be done within the military.